of some bright morning when this slobbing's all right. Fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away. Oh, glory, I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Shadows of this life have gone, I'll fly away like a bird from the prison walls I've flown. I'll fly away, sing it loud. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by.
One more time.
Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away in the morning when I die. Hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Oh, y'all sound good this morning. Welcome to Franklin Baptist Church. Won't you stand as we sing 425 in your hymnal.
There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still. In all of life's ebb and flow, Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Soon he's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. Great to see you on a beautiful Sunday morning. We're glad that you're here, and if you're visiting with us, we're especially glad to have you in beautiful downtown Franklinton this morning. All your announcements on the back of your bulletin, I hope that you'll take a moment and read those. A lot of people call me during the week and ask me about different things. If you have Facebook, each Monday, usually by Monday evening, we put a newsletter on the church page. It has everything that we're doing that week and future activities on that. We try to keep the prayer list up to date on that Facebook page, so just check it out. Now, tomorrow may be a little late. It may be Tuesday before I get it posted because of Ronnie's funeral, but always check that out on our church Facebook page. Takeaway Tuesday, this will be the last Takeaway Tuesday for until after the summer. So if you have children, make sure that they're here on Tuesday evening. Vacation Bible School starts on the first Sunday in June. There's some Vacation Bible School needs printed in your bulletin. And then there's this sheet in the back of the church. It's on one of the podiums back there. We need some other things besides that. We need some pop-up tents. If you have a pop-up tent, we need it. We need paper towel and rolls and toilet paper rolls. We need flat sheets, fake greenery and ferns, terracotta pottery, We need outside cushions like you put in your chairs. The sheet back there explains what we need. We need these things to borrow during Bible school. So if you have some of these things that we can use for Bible school, please see Sheila, Candance, or Ebony, and let them know that you have these things and provide those for us for our kids during Bible school. If you're on the Safety and Security Committee, Jamie will meet with you right after church today. And don't forget our Patriotic Picnic. It's coming up on July the 1st. Oh, yeah, there is a time change on that. We're going to start at 5:30 instead of 4 o'clock. 5:30 instead of 4 o'clock. Okay, who has a birthday or an anniversary? Got another announcement.
The men's ministry, we met for breakfast yesterday. Was it yesterday? Yeah, it was yesterday. I was on Facebook, Cole. Anyways.
Y'all got to start reading that Facebook.
Going to have to read Facebook. So we're going to have a fishing day where we want to take some kids out. Ricky Jones is supplying the pond. And yes, Buster, he said he'd mow around it before we got up there. So we appreciate that, Ricky, so much. But we just wanted to get the word out now, June 10th. Okay? Mark that down, June 10th. If you know a kid that would like to go fishing, we're going to teach them how to fish. We're going to, I mean, we're all professionals. So we've caught a few fish here and there. But we're going to take them fishing that day, and then we're going to end the day with roasting some hot dogs and stuff up here at Buster's house. So it's going to start around 4. We're going to meet over here at the FCC and take everybody over that we can to Ricky's house, and we'll fish for a little bit, and then we'll have some hot dogs and teach them how to fish and fellowship. So just keep that on your calendar.
You notice they're not going to fry fish after the fish fry, isn't it? That tells you what kind of professionals they are. Thank you, Jamie. June the 10th. That'll be a great day for all the kids. You got an age requirement, Jamie? Not changing diapers that day, okay? Got to hold a fishing pole, okay? All right, birthdays or anniversaries? Anybody? Edith's got a birthday today, and I think today's Miss Peggy's birthday too, isn't it? So, Dean got a birthday? Oh, come on, Dean. 75. Well, you may look at Dean, but we know you're not quite that old. Let's sing to Dean and Miss Edith and Miss Peggy. Take a moment and welcome each other to church this morning. Okay, if we could get you to get back to your seats. I need everybody to return to your seats, please. There'll be a baccalaureate service this afternoon at 2:30 for all the Henry County High School graduates at the auditorium, and the Henry County girls softball team will play at 4:00 this afternoon at Henry County. Also, for Ronnie's funeral tomorrow, visitations today from 2 to 6 at Newcastle, funeral tomorrow at 11. The meal for that funeral is going to be catered here after the funeral tomorrow, but we've been asked to supply drink and desserts, and I think the drink has been taken care of, but we need desserts. If you can fix a dessert and you haven't seen Debbie McKinney yet, please see Debbie before you leave this morning. Let her know that you'll be glad to prepare a dessert for that meal tomorrow afternoon. This time we want to recognize our graduates. We actually have 3 graduates from our church, so we're going to recognize those at the time. I think 2 of them are here today. So Gregory Sharp, if you'll come forward, and Braden Newton. Gregory's graduating from Henry County High School. And Greg, tell us, we got a little gift from the church and one from me and Becky. What are your plans after high school?
I'm going to go plumbing.
Okay. So you're going to fall after Ronnie Grigsby.
Yeah.
Huh? A little bit. Okay, you're going to give him some competition, huh? Ronnie said there ain't no competition. That's awesome, Gregory. Well, congratulations. And Braden, you're graduating from Louisville Male High School. Tell us what you're going to do after you finish high school. Congratulations, Braden. We're proud of both of you. Congratulations, guys. You can go be seated now, okay? Okay. All right. Okay.
Won't you stand? 3:30 in your hymn. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. We'll sing the last verse. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we know less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Now where are we going? Where are we at, Bob? Oh, he's on it this morning. Never again will I catch it, will I? There is a name I love to hear, I love to sing its worth. It sounds as music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first love me. Amen. You may be seated. We ask now that you please prepare your hearts for worship.
Week. Glad to have you back. Before I read scripture, let's look at our prayer list. We want to remember, of course, Peggy and her family this morning. Continue to remember Miss Jo. Gary had his surgery Thursday, am I right? Thursday. He was doing well, but had a tough night last night. They think he may have a intestinal blockage this morning. So remember Gary, Gina, Logan, Jewel. We're glad to see her here this morning and her pretty face. Miss Helen Irwin, Alan Head, Kathy, glad to see you here. Miss Gina Perryman. Gina had a tumor removed from her neck, and she goes Friday to see the doctor to see what that's all about. So remember Gina. Miss Betty Preston, Bobby Sharp, Sue, and Ray and Elaine, and of course the long list of family and friends we want to remember. Our scripture comes from Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. Our title of our sermon this morning is, Does God Make Mistakes? Then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, and over every living creature that moves on the ground. May God add his blessings to the reading of his holy word. Let's pray. Father, thank you this morning that we can gather together as your children. Lord, we thank you for creating us in your image and for placing within us the ability to love one another. This morning, we especially lift to you Peggy, Bridget, and their family. Lord, we love them and we feel for them as we even feel for ourselves this morning. RB was a part of this community and this church for so many years, and he was a friend to so many of us. And so, Lord, there's a void in our hearts. And, Lord, we know that Peggy this morning is hurting. As her and her children and grandchildren get ready to head to the funeral home and pay their last respects, Lord. We pray for strength for them as we, again, pray for strength for ourselves. But, Lord, we rejoice this morning in the fact that Ronnie is no longer here, no longer suffering. But, Lord, he is with you and he is with Robbie. He is with his mom, his dad, his grandparents. And, Lord, that he is celebrating a new life with a new body. Lord, this morning we pray for this church service. Lord, that you would open up our hearts, our minds, and our ears and help us to hear what you have to say. Lord, we thank you that you have created us and that we do live on this earth, a beautiful earth, and that you do give us creatures, animals, birds, plants, grasses, fields, such a beautiful world in which to live. Help us to be good stewards of the land and of the waters. Lord, I pray this morning there's one person, even one person here this morning who doesn't know you as their personal Savior, that today would be the day of salvation for them. Use every part of this service. Help reach us for you. And we pray this prayer in your name and for your sake. Amen.
So the song that you see in the bulletin is not the one that I'm going to do this morning. I've struggled with it over the last couple of days, and I just didn't think it was right. And earlier in the week, I thought, well, I'm going to do this one song because I really like it a lot, and it's old, and I like old stuff. But anytime we lose a member of the church, a member of our family, it's always comforting to me when the memories start coming back. Memories that maybe from your childhood that you might have forgotten about. And it's always comforting to know that, and I can't help but think I wouldn't have those memories if it weren't for this place, if it weren't for the people in this church, old and new. If it weren't for those people, I wouldn't have those memories. And, you know, Brother Tim's coming in. There's so many memories there, so many memories of conversations about songs that Ronnie didn't like. He wasn't a huge music fan to begin with, so I always knew if he said, "Hey, good job," and then walked on, it was not his favorite song of the day. But it made me think about all of it. Amy brought home a thing from last night, from the event over at the FCC last night, talking about Miss Filson. And man, how many memories there wouldn't be if it wasn't for Miss Filson. And the beautiful piano playing and sometimes the intimidation during Bible school. And she was a sweet person, but don't cross her. You know, you didn't cross her. But just those little things, and one quick thing it made me think, you know, if it wasn't for Miss Filson, I wouldn't have the memories of I wasn't gonna do that, of growing up right across the hill in the little white house that the wind blew the curtains every day. And she told my grandmother, for 27 years, "I'll charge you $25 a month for rent and I'll never raise it," and she never did. She knew she couldn't afford much, but she never did. And you don't see that these days. And it's because of this place. And we're going through family. You know, Brother Jackie's preaching about family this month, and folks, this is family. So I urge you, bring your family here. Bring your kids here so that they can enjoy those memories that are so clear and so fond to so many of us. There's a family Bible on the table, and each page is torn and hard to read. But the family Bible on the table will ever be my key. Close of day when work was over, and when the evening meal was done, Dad would read to us from the family Bible, and we'd count our many blessings one. This old world of ours is full of trouble. This old world would also better be if we find more Bibles on the table and mother singing Rock of Ages clear for me. I can see us sitting around the table where from the family Bible Dad would read, and I can hear my mother softly singing Rock of Ages, Rock of Ages, cleft for me. Rock of Ages, Rock of Ages, cleft for me.
Jamie. Thank you so much. There is one song that RB always wanted you to sing, Jamie, and you never sang it for him. He always wanted you to sing Elvira for some reason. You never could work that into a church service, could you? Matter of fact, he always told me that he and Ronnie always wanted to sing that in church together. My question to you this morning, as we all sit here in God's house, and I want you to answer this question. Do you think God makes mistakes? The great Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, the one who existed before there was nothing, the one who created everything there is and called it good, do you believe it's possible that he can mess things up? Are you waiting for me to tell you? Well, let me stop here and let's just address a hot button issue, okay? If we're to believe the Bible, and I think we're a Bible-believing church, I know I'm a Bible-believing preacher, then I don't believe God makes mistakes. I don't believe the great God, the one who was before anything ever existed, I just don't think he makes any mistakes. And so, let's just throw it out here and get it out here in the open. I'm old-fashioned. I'm old. I'm getting ready to quit. I'm getting ready to get my horse and buggy. And I'm getting ready to go back to the dark ages. But if I'm going to believe the Bible, and I'm going to believe God makes no mistakes, the scripture we read this morning settles the transgender issue. God created what? Male and? So does God know what he's doing? And then he gave them one job to do. Be fruitful and multiply. There's no mistake. And if that's not clear enough, we get a clear picture. We go to Genesis chapter 2, verses 18 through really 24, and it says this. God says, "It's not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." But for Adam, there was no suitable helper to be found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken from the man, and he brought her to the man. And the man said, "This now is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. And this is why man leaves his father and mother and is united with his wife, and they two shall become one flesh." So now we have husband and wife living in a garden of paradise, and everything is hunky-dory, perfect for the rest of eternity, just like all marriages, right? Until we get to chapter 3. And chapter 3 begins with these words. "Now the serpent was craftier than any of the wild animals the Lord had made." The devil is a liar. He is a deceiver. He is crafty. There are at least 35 verses in the Bible that calls him a deceiver. He wastes no time interfering with Adam and Eve's relationship. God created man. God created woman. We got a whole society. We got houses and homes going to hell in a handbasket. And you know why? It's because Satan is a deceiver. He is a liar. The transgender issue is because of Satan. As soon as God gives Adam his wife, the devil goes to work. Adam doesn't even get the luxury of a long honeymoon. End of chapter 2, they're walking around naked and they're happy. Beginning of chapter 3, they look upon each other and they're ashamed to have to go get on fig leaves. Satan's never happy. He's only happy when we're miserable. Satan is a liar. And he is only pleased when families are at each other's throats and they're in torment. Couples walk down the aisle. "She's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen." Bridegrooms are standing at the front of a church or a facility, tears running down his eyes. He can't wait to say, "I do, I do, I do, for better, for worse, whatever you say, preacher, I'll do it," you know. Can't wait to take her hand, give her a kiss, marry, and walk out the church. And within days, they're at each other's throats. Satan can't wait. Tear families apart. Chapter 1, God created man and woman. Chapter 2, he's brought them together as husband and wife. Chapter 3, Satan says, "Here's a beautiful apple. Wouldn't you like to take a bite out of it?"
tempted them with sin. And now they're hiding from God, the one who created them. They're living shamed in the Garden of Paradise. Chapter 4. Two beautiful little boys come along. Now we have family. The birth of Cain and Abel, two sons. I want you to notice, now we have family. God ordained the family before he did the church. Family's important. But what happened between Cain and Abel? Big time problems. Two brothers who can't get along. Two brothers who are jealous of each other. Throughout the Bible, every family had their problems. Read through the Bible sometime. You think your family's dysfunctional? There's not a family in the Bible that wasn't dysfunctional. Abraham with his two wives, Hagar and Sarah, and their two sons, Ishmael and Isaac. Oh, man. Can you imagine taking care of one wife? Can you imagine taking care of two wives? Then there was Noah. Noah was a good man, right? God found favor in Noah. He's the one that created the ark, built it, put all the animals on there, two by two. His three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The Bible says he's a righteous man. But chapter 9, Genesis, we find out one day Noah's laying in the tent. He's drunk. Down south, we call him, he was butt naked. Laying in the tent drunk. Ham comes along and he walks in the tent and he sees his dad. He runs back to his two brothers and he says, Daddy's laying over there in the tent. He's butt naked. Two brothers back in the tent with a blanket and cover him up. When he sobers up, they said, Daddy, Ham came in here and saw you with no clothes on. Noah gets angry. Asks God to curse Ham's descendants, which were the Canaanites. Dysfunctional family. Then there was David, man after God's own heart. But we all know all about old David. We remember what happened with him and Bathsheba. Their first son, illegitimate son, died 7 days after he was born. David had three other sons that died during his lifetime, and another son, Adoniah, was executed shortly before David's death for trying to overthrow his throne. Sin in all of these people's lives. Good people. Abraham, Father Abraham, King David, Noah, a righteous man. Good people, godly people.
But somehow the devil, that liar, that deceiver, weaved his way into their lives and caused trouble. I could go on. I could list more. What causes problems in your family's lives? Guarantee you, when you look back, you'll find the devil had something to do with it. You see, the devil, he'll always convince you that the grass is always greener on the other side of the fence. But you need to remember, a lot of times that's where the septic tank is. He's a liar. He is a deceiver. John 8:44. Jesus was speaking to non-believers. And this is what he had to say about Satan. He says, "You belong to your father, the devil. And you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar. He is the father of lies." Our nation is under attack, not from the outside, but within. The family is disintegrating because we have stopped believing in God and buying into Satan's lies. God forbid if this church and our families ever stoop to that level. Does God make mistakes? I don't think so. No. I know God doesn't make mistakes. And if you believe in that Bible, you know as well as I know, God never makes mistakes. Father, thank you for your message. As we come to this invitation time, if there's a person here this morning who needs to come forward to bow at the pulpit or to take Jamie's hand or to come whisper something in my ear, I pray that this would be the hour of decision for them. Thank you, Lord, for you creating us, man and woman. Thank you for the gift of marriage. Thank you for the gift of children. Thank you for ordaining the family. And Lord, may we understand the importance of family and keeping family together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Jamie will be down.